tonight as part of a collaborative program. The towns of Bedford, Concord, and Carlisle have a $25,000 grant that they've been working specifically for programming related to vaping education and outreach. And we've been doing quite a bit of work, fast and furiously, over the past 6 or 8 months at this point. And this season right now, we're doing our community outreach and presentations. A couple months ago, we had one in Concord, and tonight we're delighted to have a presentation here in Bedford with Dr. Marisa Silveri. She is a behavioral neuroscientist who holds appointments as associate professor of psychiatry at Harvard Medical School and adjunct assistant professor of psychiatry at BU School of Medicine. Dr. Silveri is the director of the Neurodevelopmental Laboratory on Addictions and Mental Health in the Imaging Center at McLean Hospital. She uses MRI in conjunction with cognitive and clinical assessments to study teen and emerging brain development, with a focus on identifying neurobiological effects of alcohol and drug use and risk factors for later substance abuse, depression, and anxiety disorders. Dr. Silveri's research is funded by the National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, including a mentoring grant and the John Alden and Mental Health Mental Insight Foundations. Dr. Silveri is the recipient of the Enoch Cordes Research Recognition Award and the Young Investigator Award from the Research Society on Alcoholism, as well as the Jack H. Mendelson Memorial Research Award and the Anne M. Cataldo Excellence in Mentoring Award from McLean Hospital. She has authored over 65 peer-reviewed scientific publications and was co-editor of a special issue on the adolescent brain published in Neuroscience and Behavioral Reviews. Dr. Silveri speaks extensively on the topic of adolescent brain development. Lucky us that she's here this evening. She also speaks on alcohol and drug use and mental health. She's presented at over 120 community presentations, locally as well as nationally. She's the chair of the National Advocacy and Public Education Committee for the Research Society on Alcoholism. Dr. Silveri received a Bachelor of Science degree in Biology and Psychology from Union College and a Master's degree and PhD in Behavioral Neuroscience from the State University of New York at Binghamton. We're so delighted to have her here tonight. As you all may know, and likely what's drawn you out here tonight is this crisis that we're dealing with right now relative to vaping, particularly as it pertains to our adolescents. Here in Bedford, our last data comes from 2018. We do a youth risk behavior survey of our middle school and high school students, and the data is remarkable. I mean, 8% and 28%, 8% of middle school students, 28% of high school students self-reported that they had vaped or used vaping products within the past 30 days. That was 2 years ago from that data was generated. We're very anxious to see what the data is going to come back as in a few months when we do it in early 2020. So we'll have that to be able to present to the community as well. But we're delighted to have Dr. Silveri here today, so please join me in welcoming her.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for braving the elements to come here to hear about the teenage brain and about the harms of vaping. So that is, you know, when people ask me, what is my day job, I tell them that I study the neurobiology of what were you thinking? Anywho, so most of my presentation and how we deliver the information to the community is really against the backdrop of how we understand how the brain develops and how it works in the first place, because that is something that is not specific to any particular age or race or ethnicity, is that we all have a brain and we understand pretty much the physics of how it works. And so a lot of what we do is to try to understand from the perspective of being a teenager or how the brain develops. You know, we think about life. All of my things are just gave away the whole, and thank you very much for coming. Okay, hopefully this won't go mad and that won't keep me from working. So, when we think about adolescence, so one interesting aspect about thinking about this is that there is one thing that everybody in the room has in common, that is that for better or for worse, everybody here has been a teenager. And so if we kind of understand that, and we understand what the behavioral aspect of being a teenager is we know that it can really be great. It can be like skydiving. It can be exhilarating. It's the best time in life. There's a ton of opportunity.
But we also know that's not the whole story. We know that life can really be a roller coaster ride. Of course, at any age it could be a roller coaster ride, but particularly during adolescence. It is an emotionally stormy period of time where, you know, you're happy one minute, you're sad the next. It could go month to month, day to day, hour to hour, minute to minute, and you can really have that dramatic of a change. But of course, if we're thinking about teens, there is one really important piece that we can't leave out. You know, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that nobody, no teenager wants to be the odd duck out. My friends are doing it, you know, I wasn't invited to the right party, do I have the right cell phone, do I have the right genes? And of course, from our perspective as neuroscientists, we're thinking about a whole entirely different type of genes so that we can try to understand how all of these different aspects of being a teenager come together to really help people evolve. And that's kind of the idea here, is that it's a time in life, it's a unique time in life that really is notably about gaining new experiences with the goal of really being able to become a good decision maker. Because in the end, really the goal, evolutionary life and otherwise, is really to become independent. And so when you talk to parents about what that means for, you know, I want my kids to be independent, I want them to be financially independent, I want them to, you know, have their own job and their own life, anything from the teenager's perspective or, you know, just what their idea about becoming independent means, it's more about how do I get my freedom. So it's really the same idea. The drive is to become a good decision maker so you can ultimately gain independence, and then the end goal is really kind of different for parents and kids. But again, the shared idea that this is a passage of time that is really kind of wired for us to become better decision makers. And so if you think about it, if we step outside of human adolescence, we know that evolutionarily, there is actually a mechanism in the brain that makes kids or makes young individuals or adolescents, organisms, whatever species we're talking about, there is a notable time of adolescence. And the whole goal of this period of adolescence is really to have something in the brain that makes you a novelty seeker, that makes you a risk taker, so that you can leave the nest. Because again, the goal in evolution and in the wild is that I have to leave the nest so I can, you know, procreate with someone outside of my genetic pool. And so if you think about it, there is something wired in the brain to make that happen. I'm not going to be fearful about leaving the nest. I'm not going to be fearful about taking risks. Well, kind of fast forward to the evolution of humans, it's the same mechanism in the brain that works. Oh, I have to get out of the house. Oh, I have to become independent. But we know that there are a lot more risks that kind of go in line with the fact that, okay, I'm a novelty seeker by design in my brain, I'm a risk taker by design in my brain, but there are so many risks that nature did not intend to have to cover. Yes, you know, some sort of a predator that was coming after you. Being prepared when the winter comes, do I have enough food to get me through to be able to survive? But at least in the hands of human adolescents, what we know is that that same wiring, that same drive in the brain to help you leave the nest, really didn't anticipate the fact that substances such as alcohol, marijuana, nicotine, other types of things, so you know, social media use or anything that's rewarding, was an unintended side piece of that risk-taking aspect. And so what we know is that we know that more teens are vaping and many think it's nicotine free. I'm going to talk a lot about what vaping is. That's kind of at the end part of the presentation so that you can really kind of understand what the different mechanisms for vaping are. But what I really want you to understand first is how the brain works and how the brain develops and why the second decade of life in particular, essentially the time from age 10 to 20, is probably the most crucial time for the brain to develop. And so, you know, if we look at the statistics, I can appreciate what our public health concern is. I know why we're doing this work. I'm not here to spend more than a few slides to tell you what the rates of use are. We know, as in the introductory remarks, is that there is an alarming, dramatic increase in how much kids are vaping and how much they're trying it. And so the risks and the harms around that kind of go hand in hand with the fact that we're talking about kids who are naturally risk takers in a sense. But we can see that in eighth grade, over the last, it's pretty much doubled across the board from 2017, as you said, in the last 2 years, at least in eighth graders, it's more than doubled. In 10th graders, it's gone from 8% to 20%, and 12th grade from 11% to 25%. So this is more than a doubling. And I can probably go so far as to say, you know, putting any substance into your lungs is going to expose your brain and your body to things that are not supposed to be there. But, and this is a quote by a woman who is a pediatrician at Boston Children's. Part of the reaction has been about the flavors, because unfortunately part of the marketing ploy to get things out to the public is to make them attractive. And one of the ways that people make things attractive is to target kids and people who are the ones who this will catch on for. That's about all I'm going to say about that for right now. So I just want you to have this in the back of your mind. We all know why we're here, what we're here to talk about. I also want to say, you know, I am a neuroscientist whose job is to translate the science and deliver it back to you. So part of my job is to not just be in my laboratory and run all these studies, collect the data, and publish it, but I also feel it's one of my most important passions to collect the data and then give it back to you so that you can consume it. And so let's just kind of put the vaping piece of things aside. Even as we get into talking about, I'm going to talk a little bit about alcohol, a little bit about marijuana, and then I'll conclude at the end talking about vaping. Again, keep in the back of your mind that we really want to understand how the brain develops in the first place. And probably what's not surprising is that the brain, or the size of the weight, from the time you're born, the size of your brain increases dramatically. By the time you're age 5 or 6, your brain gets as big as it's going to be for the rest of your life. So imagine, you have a 5 or 6 year old, you have a 10 year old, a 20 year old, a 30 year old with the same size brain. So you think to yourself, wow, it's not about the size of the brain, it's about how the brain is working. And so one of the things we know is that the brain size plateaus with no further changes in volume, but during the teenage period, from 10 to 20 in particular, compared to every other decade of one's life, we know that there are the most dramatic improvements in pretty much every cognitive function. Everything we can do, we essentially learn between the ages of 10 and 20. And then from 20 and beyond, we slowly refine these processes. And we also know that it doesn't even conclude. So we used to once conventionally think that by the time you got to be 18, your brain was done. You graduated high school, or you've left high school for a job, you've gone off to college or gotten a job. Whatever you're doing, we used to think that the brain was done. Fortunately for us, the brain is not done. The brain is never done. But the majority of the developmental work really concludes in the early 20s. And we'll talk about that a little bit more. This is a very basic picture of a brain cell. So we are born with billions of neurons. And slowly, what we know is that this construction project, what it looks like, particularly in adolescence. So when I said that the size of the brain doesn't change, yet we get so much smarter, how does that really work? So I like to think about it this way. Imagine that you have a basement, an unfinished basement, and you want to renovate it. So what do? I don't know, you come in, you put down some carpets, you put in a couch, maybe put up some walls, put in a TV. You've taken the same size of the room, and by doing some internal construction, you've now changed the function of the room. It's no longer just for storage, it's an entertainment room, or whatever it is. So the idea is that we are not changing the size of the room during development. The size of the brain gets to what it's going to be, but it's really this internal construction, reconstruction, that is going to help change the function of the brain. It essentially looks like this. So here we have these billions of neurons. There are two major processes that occur. It starts early in life when you're born. It concludes sometime in the early 20s with the most dramatic changes that happen between 10 and 20. One of the first processes that happens is that the way that neurons talk to each other, so how your brain cells work together, is through these long projections. These are called axons. These axons become wrapped with an insulation. So imagine you have just a plain copper wire and you want to send a message from point A to point B. The message can get there, but if you wrap that copper wire with an insulation, with a plastic, the message is not only going to get there faster, but you're going to lose less along the way. This process in the brain is a wrapping of these projections between neurons called axons. It's called myelination. This is the addition of something called white matter in the brain. Now, I do have to apologize. I am a neuroscientist who tells really bad jokes. This is how you get better cell service. I warned you. So warned. But it is true. This is how you make neurons communicate better. You wrap the connections between them with myelin, and the message goes faster, and you lose less along the way. But I already told you that when the brain reaches this plateau, it doesn't get any bigger. And I just told you that we've added all this myelination. So by conservation of matter, we also have to take something away. And so that's the other part of the process, is that for every billion neurons that we have, we go through a process where we slowly, over time, in experience, we prune away the neurons that we don't need. So lucky for us, in the way that the brain is built, it's got an amazing amount of redundancy. You do not need all the neurons that you are born with. And slowly over time, through experience, through genetics, through pruning, you prune away the neurons that you don't need, the extra ones, and you keep the best of the best. So the idea is that with the development of the brain, what you're really, the goal here is to gain efficiency. And so a way to gain efficiency is to keep the neurons you need and make them really good communicators. And so that's essentially what this process looks like. And I think one of the benefits, so this is not new information. I'm not here to tell you, oh, guess what? This is what happens in brain. What I'm here to tell you is that things that we've known about the brain for a really long time have really largely been confirmed by using imaging. So the type of imaging we use and many others use is magnetic resonance imaging. So if anybody ever have an MRI, you may know it by that lovely sound. So that is a tuning into the molecules in your brain. But one of the reasons why it's so advantageous to use, particularly in kids in the developing brain, is that it's entirely non-invasive. So it's not exposure to x-rays like a CT scan. It's not exposure to anything radioactive like a PET scan. I'm not saying those scans aren't important, but for a developing brain, if we want to understand how the brain develops in a non-invasive way, this technology has been really useful to be able to capture that information. And you can repeat it. So as if you're saying, well, if you look at a bunch of 12-year-olds and a bunch of 14-year-olds and 15-year-olds, one of the ways that people look at that now is you take someone starting at age 10 and you actually study them through the time course and you can actually see what the profile of development looks like. And so, you know, if you're kind of thinking about these structural changes that we're talking about, we're adding all this myelination, all this white matter. We're also pruning away the neurons, so you can see it a little bit better in this cartoon. This is a picture of a brain as if someone were looking straight ahead at you. What you can see is these are all the brain cells. These are the connections between them. And you don't have to be a radiologist or a neuroscientist to appreciate the fact that within a decade of time, there are such significant changes that you can actually see it to the eye. So you can tell that those two pictures are very different. We've pruned away the neurons we don't need, and we've replaced it with good connections between them. I'll show that to you one more time, because it is this dramatic. Over a short period of time, you can see dramatic pruning and dramatic myelination. And what you have on the other side of that is a more functional brain. So this is a picture of a brain as if someone were looking in this direction. And you know, one of the things that imaging has been really great for is to confirm what we've, again, kind of always known. What parts of the brain serve what functions? And so we can pretty much map all of that out, but one of the reasons why I have the frontal lobe, the area right behind the forehead in orange, is that because all of that pruning and all of that myelinating that goes on in the brain really happens across all of the brain from the time you're born, but the last part of the brain to prune and myelinate to become efficient is actually the frontal lobe. And if you look at the frontal lobe and all of the functions of the frontal lobe, you can see there are things like, how well do you pay attention? How good is your working memory? Can you hold things in mind? Can you think abstractly? So what would happen if? Also, cognitive control. How well are you able to not only know the right answer, but hold back the wrong answer? And then finally, the end of this long list of executive functions is decision making. All of these things fit together. All of these executive functions are what set aside being dependent to independent, or at least stages of independence. And so because the frontal lobe is the last part to prune and myelinate, it really kind of lead us to ask the question, well then when is the brain adult? And so we can look at these young individuals and know that they are highly dependent on their caretaker. They can barely walk, they can't feed themselves, they can't go to the store, they can't make money, they can't do anything. But we know that slowly over time, we're not the only people doing this really important work, is to show that how you get from here to here and ask the question, because now you have people who look like big adults, who may be 18, 19 in their early 20s, who look maybe even older than some people who are older than them. But the question is, or the million-dollar question is really, when does the brain neurobiologically become adult? We're not talking about the legal abilities of someone to make decisions. And so what we really know, it's been pretty conclusive, that it is really not until the mid-20s. And for every presentation I give or every next study that's come out that's been peer-reviewed in, you know, scientific journals, we know that in the early 20s, 25, maybe even later. Because think about it. If our brain couldn't continue to change, what would be the purpose of you sitting here right now? If you couldn't learn something, so learning is actually changing your brain. There's something called neurogenesis. It's the creation of new neurons. And the way that we create new neurons is I'm giving you new information. It's novel. It's having an effect in your brain The more you think about it, the more you practice it, the more it will become learned. And as you've learned something and you've set down that track, now you have a whole new neuronal pathway. So you may never be able to talk about cell service the same way after tonight. And so how do we control the brain? So this is an example of what we do in our laboratory. This is just one example of how we can use an MRI scanner to understand function of the brain. This is called a very basic go-no-go test. This is a computerized version of Simon Says Do This. So essentially, we have a large circle, a large square, and a small circle. Now someone's laying inside the MRI scanner, and they're pressing a button very quickly. Every time you see these shapes, press a button, press a button, press a button, press a button. The entire time, we're collecting a signal from the brain. That's what the noise is doing. It's tuning in to how quickly your molecules in your brain are spinning, and then it lets off energy, and that's what we're measuring. Oh, but every time you see the small square, don't press the button. And so what I want you to do, I'm going to actually invite you to participate. This is what the camera's on me, not on you. And it's a cold winter night in December, so you might as well, you know, give it your go. Every time you see the large circle, the large square, or the small circle, I just want you to give a little hand raise. When you see the small circle, don't raise your, or the small square, don't raise your hand. Is everybody ready? Yeah, are you out there?
Yes.
Okay, ready? Go. Excellent job. You did not read the fine print. Congratulations, you just completed your first frontal lobe exercise of the evening. I'm sure you've been doing frontal lobe exercises all day, but this one was with intention. And so what we know is that every time you put your hand up, it takes your brain significantly less energy to make a response than to hold one back. And that seems almost impossible, that it could cost you more energy to not do something than to actually physically do something. Well, that is the frontal lobe working, and well, one of the things we know is that this improves with age. And if you have a window into the brain, I'm not sure what I think. Something's not happening with my brain, don't look. So, I'm going to try to be very ginger with this. So, what you see here is what lights up in the brain, right? Every time you're performing this, now one thing I want to tell you. So this is an fMRI image, a functional MRI, which essentially is measuring indirectly the activation of brain cells. One of the things we know is that when you see more activation, more is not always better. Okay? That's now you will be an expert, a resident expert in understanding fMRI. It depends on what you're asking the brain to do. Under some circumstances, more is associated with better performance. But sometimes more activation is also less efficient. So keep that in mind as you go. So every time you look at these Jackson Pollock splash brains, keep in mind what they're actually trying to say. But interestingly, if we had two audiences, if we had teenagers here, and we had adults over here, and we had to perform the task, pardon the pun, the teenagers would beat you hands down. Their reaction time, super quick. Adults, it might be on a millisecond level, go slower, but they're also more accurate. So this is the speed versus accuracy trade-off. One of the things we do, and we almost don't even notice, because again, it's on a millisecond level, that we slow down enough so that we can actually be more accurate of things. And so that is what it looks like. Now, I will tell you just one side note. I do this presentation to audiences of thousands of teenagers. And across all of my career, I've given presentations to every permutation of an audience you can imagine. And I can clearly say that the most intimidating audience I've ever had is an audience of 1,000 teenagers who I'm pretty sure are making fun of my clothes or, you know, tweeting something or whatever, snapping, chatting about me in some way, shape, or form. But the idea here is that we know how the brain is working. And when I watch kids perform this, they love it. They're putting their hands up, they're laughing, and I always have at least a few people in the audience who decide, I'm gonna just keep my hand up the whole time and put it down when the small square comes, which I actually think is brilliant because it is another way to obtain the result you want. It's just not the correct instruction that I gave. So there are different ways that you can see kids will come up with alternative strategies to reach the same end game. And that's not a bad thing. That does reflect flexible thinking, but it's also not following the direction. Okay, next part of the experiment. Again, you'd be laying in the MRI scanner. What I want you to do as quickly as you can, sorry that my slides went ahead, I hope you didn't notice anything. What I want you to do is I just want you to name the color of the blocks that appear on the screen. And so please perform this task, and you can do so out loud. Is everybody ready?
Yes.
Don't be shy. Are we all ready?
Yes. Yes.
Excellent. Go.
Green, red, blue, green, blue, red, green, red.
Now you're all super slowing down, so you're perfectly accurate. Next part of the experiment, as quickly as you can, I just want you to read the words on the screen. Everybody ready? Is everybody ready?
Yes.
Excellent. Go.
Red, green, blue, green, red, blue,
green, red. Excellent job. Last part of the experiment, as quickly as you can, I want you to name the color of the ink that the words are written in. And I'm sorry. You ready? Go.
Blue, red, blue, green, red.
Feels a little like marching through peanut butter, right? You read each of these and you think to yourself, why was that so hard? Well, you've probably seen this type of an email or a text in some way, shape, or form. Someone sends this to you, it's like, why can I read this gibberish? The brain, most people can read words even when the letters are mixed. The brain is excellent at language and reading. So one of the things we know is that reading is an incredibly automatic process. Now, you learn to name colors long before you learn to read. It is not a difficult task, but the moment you start to read, it is so automatic that your brain actually fills in the right answers. How many times have you ever proofread the email 100 times and you hit send, and you realize, oh, I misspelled the first word. That's because our brain is wired to monitor our errors, and it fixes it for us in our mind. That is a fantastic feature of the brain. And so, again, naming colors is not difficult, but when you pit the two against each other, I apologize, I conflicted your brain. Well, we know this is called the Stroop effect. This was something that was, you know, developed by Stroop in the 1940s, that actually tuned into people who had damage to their frontal lobe. And what they found was that if someone had a frontal lobe injury, that they actually could not, they were so affected by the interference of the reading versus the naming. And you could feel yourself doing it. It's like, red, green, your want and need to read. Well, guess what? The brain, again, has to work significantly harder to hold back the want and need to read. If you listen to yourself, you know, you did the first stage and you read the color, you know, you named the colors of the blocks, and then you went really fast when you read the words in the last one, super slowed down, tried so you knew what you wanted to do, you started to say the wrong thing, but then you corrected yourself. So this is all the frontal lobe working together. And the brain has to work harder to hold back. This is the frontal lobe working. Congratulations, your second frontal lobe exercise for the evening. And guess what? This gets better with age. Remember, we're pruning, we're myelinating, our frontal lobe functions are coming online, and this is why. And again, if you have a window into the brain, what we can see. Now, one other myth that I always like to bust for people is that, is it true that you only ever use 10% of your brain? That is an absolute myth. You use all of your brain all of the time. It is really such a fantastic symphony of how our neurons work together seamlessly to produce our behavior, our thoughts, our actions. And so all of these things work together. And across the naming the colors and the reading the words and the holding back the want and need to read, we know that there are specific parts of the frontal lobe that you have to activate to do that last part, the annoying part, correctly. So these are parts of the frontal lobe. And what you can see, again, keep in mind that more is not always better, but in this context, you want to activate more of these regions of the brain. One of the things that we see in kids is that when they're young, when they're 10, 11, 12, they actually activate a lot of brain. So they have a lot of resources they're using to perform the task. As you get older, what that pruning and myelinating gives you is more efficiency. So you can use half the neurons to do twice a better job. And so it's kind of like, you know, you could think about 10-year-olds playing basketball, they might need a team of 10 on 10. Whereas by the time you get to be 20, a 5-on-5 works really well. You're efficient, you're better, you're faster, and that is what we're seeing in the brain. And so even in the same teenager, one, as I mentioned, one of the benefits of using imaging is that we can do this longitudinally, repeatedly, in the same kids over and over. It kind of helps us to identify or understand questions about the fact that, you know what, everybody's different. There are a lot of individual differences, and by actually looking at some of these profiles over time, it's helping us to appreciate that. Even over the course of just one single year in a teenager, you can see significant shifts in the parts of the brain that activate when you're performing the task. Over time, you get significantly better every single year. But what parts of the brain you're using shift dramatically based on how efficient your brain is becoming. And you can see it in two different parts of the brain. And so this is really dramatic. There's even been some evidence published by, you know, really sophisticated neuroscience labs that show even in the course of 6 months in the same kids, you can see myelination, pruning, and changes in neurons that are activating in a very short time course. That's within one school year. You can see significant differences. And whether you're teachers or parents of teenagers, if you think about the things that kids are really good at doing at the end of the year compared to the beginning of the year, organization, you know, what does their locker look like? How well can they organize their schedule? You can see over a short period of time dramatic improvements in this. And this is partially due to, you know, this pruning and the myelinating. But let's kind of step outside of the laboratory for a moment, because we can't take everybody and put them in a brain scanner. That is not realistic. So what about a real context in the real world? So you're faced with tough choices. This is really about decision making, and I know you are all here to hear about vaping, but it's so crucial to understand what makes the brain vulnerable to substances and what makes the brain vulnerable during this developmental process. Because if we get our developmental process off track, then there's going to be even bigger risk on the other side of this. But let's say that, here's the context. What do I do after class? Now, I've tried very hardly across many different schools to use the example of you're in class and the bell rings. Although bells don't always ring anymore in some schools, I guess it's a sign of the time. So it's, let's just say you're sitting in class and the bell rings, right? That's a pretty good trigger. The school's over. And so the context is, I have a math test tomorrow. And so what do? Well, probably without thinking, bell rings, boom. I'm gonna hang out with my friends. Or I'm gonna get on social media. Or I'm gonna do a whole host of things. For the purpose of this experiment, we're just gonna say, or this example, we're gonna say the quick response without even thinking is you wanna hang out with your friends. Well, what happens if you take a second? Bell rings. Okay, hold on, what do I have to do today? Oh, right, I have that math test. I'm grossly oversimplifying this, but we know that if we may do some behaviors, we make choices all the time. If we go with some choices as opposed to other choices, those choices are going to have different outcomes. And so one of the things I find always works with kids is everyone's interested in what their grades are and how they can perform better, and they want to get the better grades. And so think about it. If you have a quick response and you kind of blow off the math test, you don't even think about it, chances are more likely that you're not gonna do as well. But let's say that we did think about it for a second, because we know that myelinating, pruning brain, becoming more efficient, can think a little more abstractly. You think it out, oh, I'm gonna study for tomorrow's test, and then I'll hang out with my friends. Chances are you're gonna do better on the test. And so, as I alluded to in the beginning, you know, my job as a neuroscientist is to understand the neurobiology of what were you thinking. So anybody in the audience ever use that phrase with your teenager? How about with yourself? Right? We all have this moment where we've said, oh, what was I thinking? And so that's really the other piece of the story here, because I talked about pruning, I talked about myelinating, and I talked about the frontal lobe and everything it does and how it comes online, and that's one of the most vulnerable pieces of the brain, right? Being able to inhibit incorrect responses or incorrect behavior or doing dangerous things. But what is the frontal lobe working against? You know, there's a whole other sea of brain out there, and one of the most important features of the brain is something called the amygdala. This is a very primitive structure that sits very deep in the middle of our brain, and it serves an incredibly important function. It comes online very early, and it serves to help us survive. And so what is the amygdala important for? So here I am in the middle of the presentation, and the fire alarm goes off. What do? Do you think about it? No. Where's the exit? How do I get to safety? We don't even think. It makes sense that you would have a part of your brain that is wired that you don't have to think, you just do. You know, you're not walking down the street and all of a sudden you turn around and a lion is chasing and you're like, oh, that's a nice looking lion. No, go, Don't think about it, go. So why would that be adaptive in the brain? When you're young, you have to survive. We have to pay attention to stimuli in the environment that give us cues about whether we are safe or whether we are at risk. And so the amygdala is a very important structure. It also happens to be the seat of where a lot of our emotions are. And so if you think about it, have you ever had that experience where you've gotten the email from a colleague or a friend and it's just infuriated you, and you write out your response and you hit send? What was I thinking? So my advice to my mentees always is, if you get an emotional email, especially on a Friday, write out your response, because your amygdala wants to have that expression of anger or sadness or whatever it is, and put it aside. So I have a good friend, Barbara Green, who's a clinician on the South Shore. She's been treating adolescents for the last 3 decades, and we give presentations together a lot. I do the neuroscience, she does the clinical piece, and she really offers parents and teens really great advice. It's to use something called the 10-10-10 rule. Has anybody ever heard of it? It is not by a famous neuroscientist. It is by the famous Susie Orman, who last time I checked was not a neuroscientist. The 10-10-10 rule asserts this. If you have to make an important decision, wait 10 minutes, 10 hours, 10 days. The more important the outcome, or the bigger that the risk, the longer you should wait. And this works perfectly with neuroscience. We just have to change the time scale. We're not going to wait 10 minutes, 10 hours, 10 days. If you could wait 10 seconds, if I wait for 10 seconds, you're going to think something's wrong with me. The idea is that if you could wait 10 seconds, it gives your frontal lobe a little more time to engage, right? Just like when you were doing that task, red, green, if you really slow down, you increase your accuracy by a factor of 10. If you get that email from your colleague and you write out your response and you put it aside, you wait 10 seconds or 10 minutes or wait till Monday, chances are you're going to come back to it and be like, I can't believe I was going to send that. And so really, now let's put it in the context of kids who go to the party. And they know, they've heard that the brain is vulnerable and it's developing and substances aren't good for it. It can really, you know, detract from development, increase risk for later problems. But they're at the party and there's peer pressure and there's emotional storminess and there's novelty seeking and risk taking, and someone offers you a beer or a Juul or marijuana, name it. Doesn't matter what it is. Wait 10 seconds. Hold on a second. I just have to go text my mom. Giving the frontal lobe 10 seconds for your decision making could really be the difference between a better decision or a decision with a better outcome than one with a worse outcome. And so this is something, and again, to kind of touch on the fact that we are all individuals, there are some people that might need a 12-12-12 rule, right? It's whatever kind of works within your system. And so some of the things that we've seen, we know, again, writing out that response to that email that infuriated you is very important for your emotions. And that's without even thinking. But we know that the amygdala is very responsive to stimuli in the environment that trigger survival or threat or fear. Here's an example of what we show people. We put people in an MRI scanner, and you just show them. There's no task to do. There's no button to press. You just show them pictures of people, oddly looking people, with fearful faces. And what we know is that that actually activates the amygdala. Whether you're 8 or whether you're 20 or whether you're 60, when you are looking at a picture of someone with a look of fear, your amygdala activates. But guess what? The other piece of the story is, when you're 8, your frontal lobe doesn't do much when it's looking at fear. But as you get older, along with that amygdala activating, you also get a lot of frontal lobe activating. That is the brakes on the emotional responsiveness. Now we're adults by virtue of their, you know, myelinated and pruned brains, good at decision making? Not always. There are a lot of other pieces to the story also. We know that, you know, the example of the strict test where you have to hold back the want and need to read. So anybody in the room sleep deprived today? Most people are sleep deprived. One of the things we know that sleep deprivation in particular is really most dramatically impactful on the frontal lobe. Because remember, the frontal lobe uses more energy than pretty much anything to hold back incorrect responses. And so some of the things you find, if you were to take half of the audience that got a great night of sleep last night and half of the audience that was sleep deprived and you had them do the Stroop test, the sleep deprived group would perform significantly worse and almost look as if they were intoxicated. That is how much of an impact loss of sleep can have on your frontal lobe function. And so interestingly, here's another example of a task that we do where you just show people pictures of food. It's not just high calorie foods, but it's also low calorie foods or, you know, food related items or non-food related items. And what you can see, again, there's no task here. This is just passive viewing of stimuli in the environment. What you can actually see is that this is the amygdala. This is in the brain of teenagers. This is the amygdala activating when you see food stimuli. Now, if you're starving, if you've not eaten yet, your amygdala activates even more. If you're satiated, your amygdala does not activate as much. And so if you look in the brains of adults, and I think this is probably one of the most important pieces, this is not a better or worse. This is just different. So here you have the amygdala activating in adults, but you also have all of this activation in the frontal lobe. And you think to yourself, well, as an adult, sometimes I make poor fast food choices, right? I know for me that if I'm in my lab late working and I'm writing a grant and I'm exhausted, that cheeseburger is way harder to inhibit eating than, say, the salad. But the idea is that the frontal lobe works together with the amygdala to help control some of that more impulsive responding. And that's, again, very functional. You know, when I showed you the fearful faces, one of the things that's really cool is if you show people fearful faces, so you show them the fearful face in milliseconds, and then you cover it over with a face that's just neutral, you actually would not know that you saw anything different, but your brain would still activate. It happens on a millisecond level. That is how quickly the amygdala works. Now, one of the things we know that's incredibly on the rise are anxiety problems. You know, across the board for most ages, particularly in youth, we know that anxiety is really rapidly impairing a lot of kids. And so if we think about that, that is one of the things that the amygdala does. It responds with anxiety. And if you think about either anxiety disorders, or if you think about conditions like post-traumatic stress disorder, you know, we're in the audience, the fire alarm rings. Let's say that that happens, we all shuffle outside. We wait for the fire department to come. I saw they're very close by, they wouldn't take long to get here. We finish, they turn off the alarm, we all come back and I say, okay, I was talking about the amygdala and the fire alarm goes off again. Is your brain gonna have the same response the second time around? Probably not, because the frontal lobe steps in and says, hey, wait a minute, you're probably not in danger. You've learned something about the situation. In some examples of early exposure to trauma or post-traumatic stress disorder or anxiety disorders, one of the things we know is that there is a discrepancy in how well the amygdala in the prefrontal or the cortex, the frontal lobe, talk to each other. It's not a better or worse, it's a different. And so part of it is that we really have to preserve the developmental process of the frontal lobe because ultimately that is what is going to help quell anxiety. So again, keeping all of this in the back of your mind is important because if we come back to what these tough choices are, the presentation is largely about substances. And whether we know what it looks like or we know what the harms are or how many people out of 10 are using these substances, we are using the same biology to make those decisions. And so just to give you a little, I'm just gonna summarize the brain biology piece of that so then we could talk about what it looks like in the brains of kids who are using substances. We know that the frontal lobe provides inhibitory control over the more rapid amygdala responses. Again, this does not discriminate between people or ages. This is how the brain works. Those brain developmental changes help to improve cognitive control, which is only coming online as teens are faced with making difficult decisions and navigating emotional responsiveness. And brain changes are ongoing as teens are initiating substance use. So one of the main features of my lab, one of the reasons why we're really interested in adolescents is because developmentally we know this process is occurring. But we also know that at the same time this dramatic developmental process is occurring, this is the only time in one's life that this happens, the second decade of life. A lot of really important things happen the first 10 years, like you learn how to walk and talk and do all those things. The second 10 years of life is the time when all of your cognitive functions are coming online to help you become a good decision maker. And so one of the things I always think about is that if you think about where we are, you know, in the Boston area, we are in a hotbed of medical technology, right? So if we are lucky, we will live to what, 80, 90, maybe 100. And along the way, you might need a new knee, a new kidney, a new valve in your heart. And we have all these medical interventions to keep our bodies young. But guess where we haven't made any progress? How do we keep the brain young? And so the idea is, if you want to have a brain to go along with a body that lasts a very long time, I think one of the best places to start is really to try to preserve this period of adolescent brain development. Because that could really be the key to keeping a brain that has the longevity to go along with the body. And so substances, this is undeniable. If you look at the literature, the published peer-reviewed scientific data, is that if you look in teens who use substances versus those that don't, you do see that the developmental time course of their brains are different. And so what does that look like? I'm going to say just a couple brief things about alcohol and marijuana, because a lot of these substances all go hand in hand. I think the most important thing to know is that from about age 12 to 13, by the time you get to be the legal age in the U.S. to drink, we know that there is an increase from about 2% of kids that drink to almost 70%. And one of the things you'll notice is that from 21 to 25, that is the highest rate of alcohol use across the entire lifespan. So here is that developmental window, where I said that the most important frontal lobe changes are occurring in pruning and myelinating. It's also the time when you have the most rapid escalation in exposure to substances. Now, these are more recent data that kind of show that, at least with regard to alcohol and what we are doing as researchers, kids are really believing that there are harms associated with drinking, in particular binge drinking, which is a pattern of drinking that's typically 4 to 5 drinks within a 2-hour period that raises your blood alcohol level to about 0.08, which is the legal age to drink. And the other piece is that you can kind of see that reflected here. When you're 18 to 25, we see huge rates of binge alcohol use that really slowly decline. So kids drink the most at a time when the brain is doing the most work. And I think probably the most important piece of the story is that the age of first use of alcohol is one of the best predictors of who will go on to have an alcohol use disorder later in life. So, you know, refrain from trying to figure out where your teenage life was in this chart. Let's talk about teenagers in 2019, almost 2020. One of the things we know is that if you start to drink around age 13, there's almost a 50% chance that you will have an alcohol use disorder later in life. If you wait until age 16, it goes down to 30%. That's still a third of kids who start drinking at that age. If you wait until 18, it goes in half again. If you wait till the legal age in the United States to drink, 21 years of age, it goes down to 9%. And so one of the other myths is you're thinking to yourself, oh, well, I bet in Europe their youth are fine because it is an integrated part of their culture. One of the things that epidemiologic studies show us is that every single country in Europe has significantly higher rates of alcohol use disorder in their youth compared to the United States, except for Turkey. And that is for religious purposes, that they don't drink as much. But again, it is the biggest predictor. The only way that you can have no risk of an alcohol use disorder later in life is to be lifetime abstinent. Let's be realistic. Most people in the United States will have some relationship with alcohol at some point in their life. About a third of the country either does not drink, I'm talking people of legal age, either does not drink or drinks in very, very low rates. A third of the country drinks in social levels, and a third of the country drinks in heavy or harmful levels of alcohol use. So, you know, I'm not here to give my personal opinions about whether or not one should drink. I'm here to say, when the brain is doing its most important developmental work, if they could delay the onset of use of alcohol, that will help reduce risk for an alcohol use disorder later in life. It will also help protect the developmental process that's occurring. And so, you know, if we have a window into the brain, what we know is that, here's another example. Teens who consistently use alcohol do worse on memory tests by about 10%. Remember, we're trying to build efficiency. And one of the things that we found is that alcohol actually makes the brain less efficient. This is one of the ways that it does it. Here's an example where you're laying in the scanner and your instruction would be, when you're looking at these different icons, press a button when an icon appears in the same exact location. And so what you want to see is what happens when something's in the right location and you press the button. If you look in teens who are non-drinkers, you see a lot of the brain lights up. This is what I like to call holding something in the clipboard of your mind, right? This is the reason why we're so thankful for smartphones, because we can't really remember anything. So we rely on technology to have good short-term memory. But for something like this, where you're using a task mirror, you're trying to hold the location in your mind, what we know in teens who are drinkers. Now, these are not teens who are intoxicated when they're performing the task. You can see that they activate significantly less of their brain. So that's partially the reason why they perform about 10% worse. And again, this is not when they're intoxicated. So even if kids drink on the weekend, we know that there are residual long-lasting effects. Even if it's a day or 2 days or 4 days, we know that even in adults, you drink, your brain is not exactly what it was. You may not have a blood alcohol level anymore. You may not feel the effects of alcohol anymore. But, you know, it doesn't matter if you are 1 or 10 or 8. If you have a brain cell and you apply alcohol or any substance to it, it's going to change how it functions. And so that is kind of the undeniable piece of things. But then you ask the question, well, you're telling me that kids who use alcohol do worse on memory tests by about 10%. How do you know their brain wasn't that way in the first place? This is kind of the classic chicken or the egg question. So that was one of the things we did. We had kids perform the Stroop test. They had never drank before. They had not initiated their first use. But how we differentiated them was whether or not they had a parent and or a grandparent who had an alcohol use disorder. This is getting at the genetic component of understanding the impact or the risk for an alcohol use disorder. What we find is that this is how much more of the frontal lobe kids who have a family risk have to activate to perform at the same level. They did not perform differently. They had to activate more neurons. They had to use more neuronal resources to perform at the same level. So again, you walk into the party, offered a beer, use 10-10-10 rule. Maybe kids who have a family history of alcohol use disorder, maybe they need a 14-14-14 rule. They need a couple extra seconds to help that frontal lobe prime the ability to inhibit the more amygdala quick responses. And so that's a really important piece of the story. And you know, even with me, so I have a five and a 7 year old, and they've heard all about the brain and neuroscience. I'm sure by the time they are 10, they're going to be so sick of hearing it. But it's a very easy discussion to have. You're sitting at the table and you're having a glass of wine with your children. How can you justify or rationalize the fact that you're drinking and you're telling them not to? And the answer really, in short, is that, listen, my brain has already gone through the developmental process, and it will not impact. My brain is not vulnerable to substances like yours is. My brain is done myelinating and pruning. You know, I said that the brain gets as big as it's going to get by the time you're 5 or 6. It does start to get a little smaller at some point, although that is not my line of investigation, although it is an occupational hazard. Sometimes I'm like, is today the day? Kind of coming down a little bit. But the idea is that if we can understand the biology, it is not personal. It's not because I don't want you to have any fun. It's because we know that the brain is trying to become efficient, and not drinking is one of the ways that can help really enhance the efficiency. Of course, it depends on which year. So 3 years ago, I had 4 talks in a row that were all about legalization of marijuana. Last year, I gave a lot of talks about the opioid crisis. This year, I have 4 talks within the same month that are all on vaping. So it seems that the consistent piece of things are new ways that substances are being presented to the community. And so, you know, marijuana use, this doesn't look huge, but there's been a doubling in how much people are using marijuana. And part of that is really shrouded around the fact that, yes, it's legalized, decriminalized. There is a message there that it seems like marijuana is less risky. And one of the things that we know is that teens are reporting binge drinking, are reporting it as more risky. But if you ask, this is in the Youth Risk Behavior Survey, if you ask perception of harm, how risky or how harmful is it to use marijuana, kids don't actually perceive marijuana as risky. And that's partially because of some of the terminology that's being used around it. Anything that's medical sounds like, oh, it must be good for me. The other things that kids say are, it grows in nature, so it's organic. But one of the pieces that we have to make sure we understand is that marijuana of today, in 2019, or even in 2010, is not marijuana of 1960 or 1970. And so a lot of the proponents of people who thought legalization would be okay, we're talking about an entirely different animal. We're talking about people who have raised the potency. So they've been able to grow marijuana in a way that has increased the potency by a factor of 4. So marijuana today is four times more potent. The legal component of marijuana, THC, is actually being favored in the growth. So people are trying to have strains of marijuana that are really high in THC. And at the same time, you hear a lot about CBD or cannabidiol, which is supposed to be one of the more protective components. And so there are different types of uses for these different substances across many different medical conditions. One of the things that we know in the past is that CBD may have been protective against some of the THC effects, but now in an effort to increase potency of marijuana, people are actually growing it in a way to decrease the CBD. So if anything, now we have a four times more potent plant that, you know, you can have a five-year-old walk along and just grab a gummy bear and all of a sudden they've been exposed to 20 milligrams of THC, which is a very high amount of THC, and it is pure. And so it is changing the brains in ways that we don't even know. So again, the idea is that there's an increase in use, but I think one of the most important things to think about is that if we look in kids who are using marijuana, we also see a significantly high comorbidity of depression and anxiety. And so one could ask the question, and we have, I have a lot of clinical colleagues who work with kids who say, I'm using marijuana because it really helps with my anxiety. It really helps with my depression. And it's hard to know. Did the depression and anxiety happen first, and I use marijuana and I feel better? Or did the marijuana use happen first, and then I have anxiety and depression when they've worn off? Because that is really a piece of the story here. I think increasingly one of the things we know is that teenagers, by and large, don't feel good in their skin. It just does not feel good. I mean, even adults, there are times where it doesn't feel great, whether it's emotional or whether it's stress or all of the above. You know, one of the things that teenagers, again, are kind of wired to do is to have this novelty seeking and have this, they have the more impulsive aspects of their behavior because their frontal lobe is coming online. But they also experience reward in a different way. So something is really, really rewarding, and then we get really tolerant to that. So now all of a sudden, we want to seek another reward. And that's really one of the things that we're seeing. And, I'm not going to tell you about the data that are out there. There's, for every bit of data that says that marijuana has no effect, there's a piece of data that says marijuana has an effect. There are the data that say that, you can go down about 8 IQ points. Then there are some that say, well, those studies don't count because they didn't measure it the right way. I'm not here to convince you either way. What I am here to say is that just like with alcohol, if you have a brain cell and you expose it to marijuana, it's going to change how that cell works. And it's all about adaptation, right? So sometimes if we think about it, if we're in the middle of the presentation and I tilted the room on you, you would feel that. You'd be like, whoa, what is happening here? I didn't even know Bedford Town Hall could do this. But after a few minutes, you would adjust to that. You'd be like, oh, okay, I don't even notice that the room is tilted anymore. But then at the end of the presentation, the room tilts back to the way it was. You're like, oh, wait a minute, I have to readjust to the room being untilted the way it was in the first place. And so when the brain is exposed to substances, and again, this does not discriminate across age, one of the things we know is when there's no substances, the brain works this way. The moment a substance is exposed, it changes how brain cells work, and the brain has to adjust to that. But in some regards, for things like alcohol or marijuana, we know that these substances can be rewarding, and we'll talk about that more in a moment. But the moment those substances go out of the system, the brain has readjusted to say, hey, wait a minute, I like this room much better tilted. And so what you end up having is more of a craving to get back to that desired state, which was more the, alteration of how the neurons work. And that tilt could be, I'm anxious, oh, I'm not anxious. And so every time you come in and out of those different exposure to substances, and those are real data. We know that alcohol, marijuana, and other drugs can really change our mood for better and for worse. And sometimes it's an immediate change for better, but then when it's out of the system, it not only goes back to where it was, it can also go to a worse place. And one of the things that we know with marijuana in particular, and what's interesting is that there's a period of time, I said about alcohol, there's about a 10% memory decrement in kids who consistently use alcohol. With regard to marijuana, we see that after people have used, so whether it's for 3 days or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we know that attention is particularly affected. We know that learning can be impacted since recent use, but also working memory. And the idea here is that in an adult, it takes about 30 days for marijuana to get out of your system. What we know, again, from some of the more peer-reviewed scientific literature is that it takes 60 days for marijuana to get out of the systems of kids. So it takes twice as long. So those residual effects, although they may be very, very subtle, it just takes neurons more time to recover from the tilt of the room. And so, you know, you saw the Stroop test. We all performed this one. Now your favorite party trick. What we know is if you look in teens who are not marijuana users, you can see that they're activating an efficient amount of brain to perform this task. But if you look in teens who use marijuana, again, they're not intoxicated when they're performing this task, and they may not necessarily perform that much differently. But one of the things we know is they actually have to activate or bring on significantly more resources to perform at the same level. So, you know, when I talk to kids, it's kind of this idea is if you have two kids getting ready to run a 50-meter dash, only one of them has on a backpack of bricks. And so the question is, for the brain, could you make a 50-meter dash with a backpack of bricks on? Sure, probably. Are you going to use a lot more energy to get to the end line? Absolutely. Could you run a mile? Yeah. Could you run 10 miles? Could you run a marathon? And so think about over the course of time. If in the second decade alone, we know that the brain is requiring more energy and it's less efficient, if we're already loading on more challenges for the brain, over time, it's going to make the brain work a lot harder. And that making the brain work a lot harder is what makes cognitive functions more impacted or more affected. And again, there are individual differences. People act in different ways, their brains are different. Some are more sensitive, some are less sensitive. But we do know that that substances during adolescence, during the teenage years, makes the brain particularly less efficient at a time when it's trying to gain efficiency. In that same task that you saw, remember we wanted to see how the brain was holding something in the clipboard? If you look in teens who are marijuana users, one of the things you see is that when they're supposed to be seeing the target and they're pressing the button, there are parts of the brain that are actually activating less than teens who are not marijuana users. But I think the more important piece of the story here is that, you know, there's what our brain is doing when you're trying to do something. And then there's what our brain is doing when we're supposed to be resting. Because that's another important part of the story too, right? When your brain, when you're just sitting quietly, mentating, things are coming in and out of your brain, you're not cognitively challenging yourself, then we have another system in the brain that kind of regains its efficiency. One of the things that we find in teenagers who are marijuana users is when the brain is not engaged in the cognitive task, now it actually overactivates. So you have a mismatch of you're performing the task, this part of the brain is not actually activating, but when you're supposed to be at rest, this brain is supposed to be quiet and quelled, it is actually now more active. And so part of this, again, because we're able to use imaging in a longitudinal way, and there's a huge national consortium right now that is trying to answer these exact questions. It's studying 10,000 kids over the course of 10 years. And so we will know more about the developmental time course of the brain. And so because they're starting age 9 to 10, they're capturing most of the kids at the beginning before they've ever used substances, before they've ever, you know, felt depression or anxiety or name it. And what we'll slowly be able to see is what the trajectory in brain looks like over time. And so the last little piece before I talk about the vaping aspect of things is that one of the most dramatic things that marijuana impacts is the reward center of the brain. And so, you know, impressively, what motivated you all to come here tonight? You know, I'm sure most of Bedford and in surrounding towns are in front of a fire, home, cozy, don't want to go to the house, but you were motivated to come here tonight. And so what is that motivational center of the brain? What motivates you to get up in the morning? What motivates you to do your job? What motivates you to do mundane things? What motivates an organism to leave the nest? There's a part of the brain, the reward center, that releases an important neurochemical called dopamine. It's the feel-good. It's why chocolate tastes good. It's why all the things that are rewarding releases this chemical. For us to have motivated behavior, we have a release of dopamine. Marijuana in particular, one of the things we know is that when you use marijuana, it activates the dopamine system. It's rewarding to feel that way. And so if you are just sitting in front of, let's just say, a painting, and you know, let's take this painting, for example. You're looking at, oh, it's a nice painting. It's got some nice green, some nice blue. Now, you've taken marijuana and you've looked at, wow, look at that green and look at that blue, because it enhances the rewarding aspects of things. But now, if you ever want to look at the painting again, in the absence of the reward, you look at the painting and it's pretty dull. And so one of the things we know is that marijuana really impacts the reward center, particularly in kids. So kids who have a different sensitivity to reward in the first place, that part of the brain is really impacted. So things that were once exciting, in the context of marijuana, that context when marijuana is not present now feels more dull, more boring, more, you know, less important. And so that is one of the parts that we know is really disruptive, is the reward center. And so how does this link in with depression? How does this link in with anxiety? There are a lot of ties that people are really starting to try to uncover. And so the last little piece here, this is the moment you've been waiting for, is to understand, well, what about vaping? Because vaping is now another piece of things. So we did a really good job reducing cigarette smoking in kids for the most part. If you look at the public health concern of how many people were smoking cigarettes, we see that there's been a significant decline over time. We've done a really good job in the last 20 years or so decreasing cigarette use among kids. And you can even see that, you know, less cigarette smoking across the ages. But now we're talking about the delivery device that allows you to have exposure to nicotine, the same chemical, and we'll talk about that in a moment, that doesn't have the same things that kind of keep us or limit how much people smoke. So people don't smoke a lot, smoke cigarettes a lot because it can make them sick to their stomach. They could smell like smoke. It affects their breath. Now we have a delivery device that in almost a seamless way can deliver in a very significant amount of nicotine to the brain in a way that is very rewarding. And so if you again look at the prevalence data, again, I don't have to tell you, I didn't need to come here tonight to tell you that vaping is increasing dramatically over time. If you look at prevalence in 2019, you know, we're talking about 25% of kids are inhaling a substance into their lungs. And so we talked a lot about the brain, and you looked at fMRI pictures and how the brain activates. The way that you actually get your neurons to work, it requires two things, glucose and oxygen. And the way that glucose and oxygen get to your brain to make your neurons work is through your blood system. And so the lungs obviously are incredibly important because that is how we exchange carbon dioxide for oxygen. And ultimately that oxygen has to go feed our neurons to be able to, you know, perform a memory task or do this droop task or hold something back, whatever the cognitive function is. And so the things we know is that anything that is taken in through the lungs is going to have a significantly faster absorption into the body, which means it gets into the brain faster than any other way, short of injection through IV. And so because of that, we have a significant proportion of kids who, you know, even since 2017 is more than doubled, who are inhaling substances into their lungs. And so now I do have to say that I am not an expert in vaping. I'm not an expert when it comes to the FDA or the CDC. And I do understand that there has been a little battle between these two governing bodies, because there is a lot of literature out there to show that adults who have been longtime cigarette smokers, that is why these devices were developed, to help adults decrease their cigarette smoking. And that has been effective. People have reported smoking less cigarettes, they are replacing it with something else. But the unintended harm is that we have kids who are trying it, because guess what? You can't smell it on me. It was originally marketed as with this really exciting flavor. Oh, and it's nicotine free. Yeah, nothing is nicotine free. There is nicotine in everything, even on the packages that say they are non-nicotine free. And so the idea is that, yes, there are all these staggering reports of illnesses that are being caused. There's illness being caused by almost everything. You could talk about marijuana or alcohol or vaping. It just so happens that since the advent of vaping, and particularly the last couple of years, there have been a number of significant deaths that have occurred, mostly because of lung infections that have resulted from vaping. And whether it's vaping nicotine or whether it's vaping THC, part of the harm that comes from it isn't necessarily the nicotine. It's more related to the chemicals. And so if we take a second to think, what is vaping? And you have a lovely display over here. Vaping is essentially the inhaling of a vapor that's created by an electronic cigarette or another vaping device. So essentially, these e-cigarettes are battery-powered smoking devices. They have cartridges that are filled with a liquid that usually contains either nicotine, flavorings, and chemicals. The liquid is heated into a vapor, which the person inhales. That's why it's called vaping, because you're inhaling a vapor. There are different kinds of e-cigarettes, including the Juul. This e-cigarette looks like a flash drive and can be charged in a laptop USB port, makes less smoke than other e-cigarettes, and nicotine levels in Juul are similar to that of cigarettes. So, a cartridge that goes into this Juul device is said to have 200 puffs, which is comparable to an entire pack of cigarettes. And most of the reports from kids who are using these cartridges in short periods of time. And part of it is because the substance, nicotine in particular, hits that reward center. We'll talk about that more in a moment. Here are some examples of what vape devices look like. If you want to see the Juul, it's over, I believe, on the table. What are the health effects of vaping? And again, I say this in the context of understanding that the original intent was to help adults reduce cigarette smoking, and it has done that. But we're talking about children who are inhaling substances into their lungs. And so just like medical marijuana and some of the changes around legalization has now made it more available for kids to come across. Same with vaping. They could bring it to school, they can vape in their jacket, and it could be really not known. But what's happening is the kids, in particular with these developing brains, are being exposed to such high amounts of nicotine that is really interfering with brain development. We may see things as lung infections or those types of medical interventions. What we won't see for a long time is what it is doing to their cognitive function and the development of their frontal lobe and other parts of the brain. So what are the health effects of vaping? We actually have no clue. Other than some of the reports that we're hearing in the news about extreme cases, we do know that it can cause serious lung damage. Vaping puts highly addictive nicotine into the body, and we knew this before vaping came along, is that nicotine slows brain development, affects memory, concentration, learning, self-control. There are some people that report that caffeine or nicotine in small doses actually enhance cognition, but we're talking about exposure to such extreme amounts of nicotine that it also becomes addictive. So you may have a gain while you're in the presence of nicotine, but the moment that it goes out of your system, now it's not there anymore. Again, we're talking about a tilted room, but instead of the room tilting slowly, it's tilting very fast. And so that feels awkward, so you want to get back to that point as quickly as you can. But I think more important than that, e-cigarettes in particular, irritate the lungs and they can cause serious lung damage because there are also other chemicals in the liquid. So there are heavy metals, there are other toxins, and we have no idea what impact they're going to have on the brain or the body. Again, our source of energy to make our brain work is dependent on the lungs. So inhaling any substance into the lungs is going to go directly to the brain. So do I have to vape every day to get addicted? Absolutely not. How quickly someone gets addicted varies. Some people get addicted even if they don't vape every day. What about e-cigarettes without nicotine? And this is where it's kind of a packaging misnomer. Most e-cigarettes do have nicotine. Even those that do not have nicotine have toxic chemicals that can irritate or damage the lungs. So what's the harm of kids that are using the Juul with a flavor? Well, it probably does have nicotine in there, but whether or not, it still has toxic chemicals in the liquid. You are heating a liquid and vaporizing it and putting it into the lungs. And so these toxic chemicals can irritate and damage lungs, and the long-term effects we have no idea. Just like we know that, if you're in an old house from the 1900s, it's not a good idea for kids to go along and lick the paint, right? Because we know that lead is harmful. We're talking about now toxins that are not only just through contact on the wall, but something that's actually being exposed within the body. And so what about vaping marijuana, THC, other chemicals? Besides irritating the lungs, these drugs can also affect cognition and mood. I showed you some of the data on what marijuana does and how it affects cognition in the brain, particularly it lasts longer, but some of the other reports have been that to get THC into the vaping equipment, also introduction of other types of chemicals. And so the last little piece here is to just try to understand what is the harm of vaping from the perspective of nicotine? I'm not inhaling smoke anymore. Isn't that better? Isn't that less carcinogenic? Not if you are replacing that carcinogen with toxic chemicals. So we have no idea the impact that that's going to have. We might not know for 10 or 20, who knows how many years. But the question is, why is nicotine so addictive? And there are actually several reasons why nicotine is so reinforcing, even if it's not as intensely rewarding as other drugs. So nicotine might not give you that same reward as, say, alcohol or marijuana or opioids, but nicotine stimulates the release of dopamine, which we talked about, in neurons that connect with the reward center, with the frontal lobe, with the amygdala, all the players that we spent our time talking about, as well as the hippocampus, which is the memory center. And this dopamine signal actually teaches the brain to repeat the drug-taking behavior. So when you're exposed to a chemical and it feels rewarding, your brain actually learns that pattern. And when it goes out of the system, it says, hey, wait a minute, I want that pattern back. And so what happens is people start to feel cravings. And then they go back because they want to have that rewarding feeling again. And so the amount of dopamine that's released is not that great compared to other drugs. If you were to look at how much dopamine is released in, say, heroin or other opioids, you get a huge big boost. But the thing about nicotine is it releases it in such small amounts. It's repeated so often, especially if kids can sit at their desk or whatever they're doing, having eternal exposure to this small device that allows them to really take the nicotine repeatedly. It's repeated so often in conjunction with many activities, it becomes part of the context. Oh, I always use my Juul when I'm behind the dumpster at school. Oh, when I'm at school. So you start to tie that reward with the drug-seeking behavior and how it's actually changed. And that is actually serving to rewire the brain. It ties nicotine reward strongly to many behaviors that are performed daily, enhancing the pleasure and the motivation from which we get from them. And so what can parents do to prevent vaping? I think really it's about education. Increasingly, I have found that kids more increasingly want to learn about the neuroscience of the brain. It carries far more weight than if I were to stand up and give them all the statistics on how many kids are using and how many are not using, or I put a cracked up car in the lawn. I think that if we all can appreciate that your neurons are working right now for you to be able to take in this information, and somehow this is going to influence some sort of behavior. I think that if we can understand that, and the fact that, yes, the adolescent brain is rapidly developing. And when I have an audience of 1,000 teenagers, what I know is that at least a third of them are probably already drinking or vaping or doing some sort of substance. But the message there is that, listen, if you've already started, sorry, good luck to you. No, the quicker you can stop, that's the other bonus, right? So adolescence is a period of vulnerability, but also a period of opportunity. The quicker kids can stop and be abstinent so that the brain can finish the developmental process, that's even more effective, because as you use for longer periods of time into adulthood, it gets harder and harder to stop the use. But just as much as kids can learn the impact of substances on their brain, not only their brain function, but on their development, the quicker they can stop. You know, this is not a message of, you know, abandon hope, all ye who enter here. This is, you have a very dynamic and vulnerable brain. And if you've used a substance, the quicker you stop, the quicker your brain can recover. Because that's the other thing that imaging has given us. You can look at people with addictions and you can see that their brains activate differently. And that different activation is associated with different function. But we also know that the longer you can be abstinent from a substance, it can actually regain what it's lost. And I think that is the hope for all of what we do. So the last little piece, what can parents do to prevent vaping? Be equipped with the facts. There's a really great vaping guide for parents just to know some of the basics. These are some of the signs of vaping, so presence of vaping equipment, product packaging, unusual online packages. Even if the flavors are no longer allowed in Massachusetts, you know, there is a big online business of how people can obtain these things. The scent is faint, but you can catch a whiff of flavoring, increased thirst or nosebleeds, decreased caffeine use. So think about it, nicotine is a stimulant. And if you're getting a stimulant, chances are, if you also have caffeine, you're going to feel much more jittery. So if teens usually drink caffeine and no longer are, use of vaping lingo and text messages or on social media, appearance or behavior changes. And really, I think the most important thing is to have conversations, real conversations, right? So Socratic dialogue, what would happen if? What are your questions about vaping? I might not know the answer, but I'm sure that we can find it. I'm sure that there is information that exists out there. And convey your own expectations. Express your understanding of the risks along with why you don't want your child vaping. If you choose to set consequences, be sure to follow through with reinforcing healthier habits. And finally, be a good role model. Set a positive example by being vape and tobacco free. And again, if you happen to be an adult or you know adults who are using vaping as a way to reduce their cigarette use, that is a very different message than talking about kids whose brains are actively developing, who are trying it because they're, by design, novelty seekers or risk takers. There's a different piece of the story here about what we are trying to achieve. And unfortunately, again, something that has been really marketed to help adults change one behavior has actually landed us in a place where it has put our youth at greater risk than they've probably ever been. And so what can parents do? What to say when your teen asks, isn't vaping safer than smoking cigarettes? So as I said, there's still significant concerns when replacing smoking cigarettes with vaping. There is now exposure to the toxins and the chemicals. And so the same goes for vaping with any substance. Ask your child why they're interested in vaping in the first place. And then, you know, this is another important one that you happen to see. This is the blue duck in the sea of yellow ducks, right? Everybody's doing it. Why do you care? The idea is that actually not everybody is doing it. For the 25% of seniors who are vaping, there's 75% of seniors who are not. So again, this is a social norm. This is understanding that, no, not everybody is doing it. And then finally, you smoke, so why shouldn't I? If you've tried to quit, respond by saying something like, you're right, smoking is unhealthy. I tried to quit and I wish I never started. So there are a lot of really good tips, I think, that we can bring into conversations so that kids can understand what the harms are. And so, you know, I've given this presentation, as I said, to a ton of kids. This particular presentation happened to be about alcohol, and one of the kids drew this on their survey back to me. I had asked them to set at least one goal and asked them how they plan to learn what they use today. Again, that presentation was about delaying the onset of alcohol use, and they know, wait to drink, or don't vape, or, you know, how we think about substances. And so the idea here is that, as I said in the beginning, it's not like we couldn't just get a new brain. So we don't know, we do not have a fraction of the information that we need to make an assessment about how harmful vaping is. We do know that it's undisputed that putting a chemical into your body, especially via the lungs, is going to get to your brain. So how big of an impact that has, we don't know, and we might not know for some time. So really, again, the idea is that the safest place is to delay the onset of any substance use during adolescence and to understand what our neurobiology is up to. So with that, this is my last little set of summary. Very rapid brain development in a short period of time. In the second decade of life, the second of maybe 8 to 10 decades of life, the brain does the most significant work. The biggest leaps in cognitive abilities occur between 10 and 18 years old. This is a time when emotions are strong and can be hard to manage. The teen brain is more vulnerable to insults such as nicotine, alcohol, and drug use compared to the adult brain, which may be further elevated by family history. And finally, really, arm yourself with the science. Because the science, you know, there are all different criticisms of how people do their science, but there is a lot of really credible science out there that has shown that substance use is more harmful to the teenage brain than to the adult brain. So with that, I just want to acknowledge my collaborators, mentees, funding sources, and if you want to stick around, I'm happy to answer some questions. So thank you.
Does anybody have questions for Dr. Silveri?
Yes. So you've mentioned earlier that the reward center in the teen brain works differently from the adults. Can you elaborate a little bit more on that?
So a couple things we know about, three main features of how the adolescent brain is different from the adult brain is that, one, we know that the adolescent brain has less impulse control, only because the frontal lobe's coming online, not because it's broken or because it doesn't work right. It is just part of the developmental process that you get better at inhibitory control or, you know, cognitive control, better at inhibiting impulsive behavior. We also know that how rewarding kids find things is different than in adults. So the impact of the reward of a system that's newly developing feels much more impactful. So substances to the younger brain feels much more rewarding. So it has a bigger risk for being addictive in kids than it does in adults.
Now, that's one part of the story. That's what substances do. But in general, we know that there is more blunted reward during adolescence also. So it may feel very rewarding, but then we have there's much quicker development of tolerance to those effects. So it may feel really rewarding, but then just like any drug, if you take a drug, you feel a certain way, your brain adapts. That's the tilting of the room. What happens now is that your neurons actually adapt to the substance being there. And they're like, this isn't supposed to be here, so I'm going to reconstruct my neurons to adjust for that. And so now, oh, wait a minute. I'm not feeling the same effect from one beer as I did before. Now I need two beers. So what happens is that the brain also can adapt to how much the substance is there. And so we know in the teenage brain, it's more rewarding at the outset, but it also has quicker tolerance. So then you have an increase. So one of the reasons why kids are more likely to binge drink in particular is that, you know, if you were to have an adult and an adolescent and you gave them alcohol based on their body weight, so you're trying to account for that, and you have them walk the line, you would actually see in the adult that they would swagger back and forth. You would clearly see that they were intoxicated. If you had the adolescent, though, who had the same amount of alcohol based on their body weight, walk from here to there, you would have no idea that they were intoxicated. And so one of the things, if you are an adult who consumes alcohol, you may have said at some point in your life, I can't drink like I used to, right? You feel much sleepier, you slur your words, you want to just lay down, because as you get older, you get more sensitive to the effects of sedation of alcohol. And so one of the things we know is that the way that adults limit their alcohol intake is that they have these cues, right? I'm getting sleepy, I'm slurring, I can't walk straight. So you stop drinking. In an adolescent, it takes significantly more alcohol to reach that same state. And that's part of the same reason that I was saying, is the brain is actually more rewarded, but also less sensitive to a lot of alcohol effects. Now, that's one piece of the story. Now, take that same adult and that same adolescent, give them the same amount of alcohol based on their body weight, and you give them a list of words to recall. The adult will remember practically the entire list. The adolescent will remember about half of the list. That is because at the same time, the third piece, so I said, less impulse control, greater sensitivity to drugs, and the third is how well the memory center is linked to the rest of the brain. So we know that 10% memory decrement in kids who use alcohol, we know that the brain is actually more vulnerable in kids to alcohol's memory impairing effects than it is in adults. And so I half jokingly say that if you have kids come home, if you want to know if they've been drinking, don't smell their breath or have them walk the line, give them a list of words to recall. But if you think about the danger there, think about the whole reason why we sit in a classroom, to learn and remember. So the outward signs of intoxication, whether it's alcohol or marijuana or other drugs, the outward signs of intoxication take much higher drug levels for kids to feel it. But the thing that is actually more impacted is something we can't see, which is the memory center, learning and being able to remember. So, you know, it holds for most of the drugs. It's about efficiency in the brain, but those are really the three pieces. And so if you're driven to drink or use drugs or vape because of the rewarding properties, it's also going to affect your impulse control, but it's also going to affect memory. So you can't really take any one of those pieces apart, but they are three really important pieces that people are really just now, with where we are in neuroscience, trying to understand how they all fit together.
You mentioned that marijuana is metabolized differently in the teen body. Does that apply to vaping or alcohol or any of the other substances, and how does that affect development? Is that an independent thing, or is it not known, or what?
So it's not necessarily body metabolism, that THC. So it's how neurons function. The amount of time it takes for your neuronal activation after marijuana takes twice as long to get back to the same level. And it could be partially about metabolism. We know that with adolescents, walking the line versus, you know, the adult swaggering, the adult walking the line, or the kids walking with a higher blood alcohol level, it's not because they're metabolizing alcohol faster. It's because their neurons are more adaptive, right? So again, this is a period of time when that amygdala is there to help them survive. The brain is really plastic, which is a great thing. And so when the teenage brain is exposed to substances, it wants to adapt, and it can do so very, very quickly. And so part of it is not just how quickly a teenager's metabolism turns over a drug. It's about how quickly the brain adapts to it. The young brain is really good at adapting to things, so that it almost, again, requires more of the substance to feel the same desired effect. So there are a lot of pieces. Metabolism is probably one piece of it, but more of it is about how rapidly the adolescent brain, its, you know, intention is to be adaptive, to keep the organism safe and survive. But what it actually does is allows them to be adapted to a substance that now when the substance isn't there, there's now craving, because through the reward system, it's actually felt good at the same time. Well, thank you, everybody. I hope everyone has safe travels home, and congratulations to your reward centers for coming.
Well, I want to thank Dr. Silveri, and thank you all for coming out tonight. If you have any questions that might pop up after the fact, you can contact your local Board of Health. I'm not sure if everybody here is from Bedford. We have other communities that are participating, but we have a lot of resources as part of our grant that we're working on now. We're happy to share them with anyone that might give us a ring or to come by the office at any time. So thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you.